But let's talk about inclusions, because essentially what this means is these are the 11 things, layman's terms, that imply that you are cashing out. Now, remember, the benefit to your QOF investment election is to leave it and let it ride, meaning leave the gains and let it ride for 10 years. However, in some situations, you may choose that it's worth cashing out at any point along that, some or all of it, depending, but some of it. And so what are the things that would trigger cashing out and what are the things that do not? Meaning, how could you move that money around into different estate structures and things like that without triggering it? So this is very clear and clarifying. And so here's what they are. Real sexy stuff here. Taxable disposition of all or part of the QF investment. Essentially, if you dispose of the investment or if your fund does and they don't abide by some of the rules that we'll talk about in a second, like the 12-month reinvestment thing, that would qualify as cashing out. And so the tax would come due. Now, if that was after 5 years, you're going to get that 10% step-up basis. If that was after 7, 15. But if it was before 10, you're not going to get the full exemption on the gain above your basis. So again, cashing out. Taxable disposition of an S corp that holds an interest in QOF ownership that is where there's a management change greater than 25%. So this might stick around to Jonathan's question a little bit. Jonathan's question is, can you buy the shares of a wholly owned entity off of another party rather than leaving your money and theirs in the entity? I might ask you for some clarification on that, Jonathan, because I kind of get it, but I'm not sure I totally understand the question. Or what you're trying to ask there. So feel free to put some more into the chat as I keep talking. What is the ratio of equity to debt when developing a building, and how is it related to the land value versus construction costs? Okay, we're going to hit on that in a second. So that one we'll get on when we talk about land banking and some of the other things here in a second, substantial improvements. But the first one may be related to this disposition event. So give me some more comments in there, Jonathan, to clarify maybe that question a little better, and I want to make sure I answer it. In certain cases, a transfer by a partner of an interest held directly or indirectly. And so in certain cases, a transfer. So you'll have to get with the tax people on that. But obviously, if you transfer your interest and you do it a certain way versus another way, it could trigger a cashing out event. Now, here's where we'll get a little bit more detailed on what you can do, because they've spelled this out in the new guidelines. A transfer by gift of a qualifying investment. If the gift that would trigger it, right? So if you transfer this as a gift, you give it to, you know, your father, your kid, your mother, whatever, then that would trigger cashing out, and the tax would become due and at whatever, you know, discounted basis or not that it is based on when you did it. However, if you take your interest, so your limited partnership stake or whatever it is in the QOF, and you gift that to a grantor trust or through your estate, then that's excluded, meaning you can gift this from, you know, one way of holding it, either as an individual or whatever, to your grantor trust, which you are the owner of, and that would not trigger, because essentially, even though you're transferring the entity by which it owns it, because it's your trust or you own it, they're letting you do that. Again, that's really good for estate planning purposes. So that's a non-triggering event. So again, transferring it as a gift will trigger. However, if you gift it to your grantor trust or through your estate properly, then you will not. So that's good. Get with your accountant again on that to figure out exactly how to do that and what kind of things you may need to be thinking about as it relates to your long-term estate planning and making sure those gains are tax exempt. Distribution to a partner that has value greater than the basis invested. Distribution of property of QF stock under 301. Again, I'm going to throw up right now so that you don't have to ask me what 301 is and I don't have to waste time being boring because I'm not an accountant. I'm going to give you the 169 pages just in case you have not had access to it. So if you go here and you can download this, this comes right off the IRS's site. You can go deep into here. I forget exactly which page 301 and 302 are on, but as it relates to these other ones, you can kind of find it. It's actually pretty readable. And so, you know, look for those sections and get yourself familiar with these inclusions. We'll talk about those if they come up in specific questions, but here's what the 11 are. Let's talk about some key terms and then get to some questions here. So substantially all. Now, what this means is 70% of tangible property must be owned or leased inside of the QOF. So for an investment to qualify, it must substantially all, that'll be the term that you'll see, in a qualified opportunity zone. And so 90%, so if an investment is 70%, so I'm going to do this. I'm going to come off screen here for a second, stop the file share, and just show this on camera. So I'm going to use Q-tips because they're visual. So that's 70% of this Q-tip. So if I invest in this Q-tip, and the green represents the amount of this Q-tip's assets that are inside of a QOZ, it is a qualified investment, meaning it will be allowed and all those rules apply. However, if it's 50%, it's not. And so when you look at these investments, that's part one. Now, part two is the key part that can confuse the heck out of people the first time they read it, confused me the first time I read it. So I'm going to pull this back up. Over the 10-year period, the 90% asset test also applies. So what that means is that if I have, let's say this box is my 10-year period, and I have 10 investments that are 70% tangible assets owned or leased inside of a qualified opportunity zone, okay, then I need to maintain at least 9 of them for that 10-year period. So I could have 9 out of my 10. So if these were each $1 million investments, at the end of that 10 years, 90% of my investments has to be in a qualified opportunity zone. So let's say I really like this property, but it's only at 50%. I could have this property as part of the fund's 10% allocation to a non-qualified opportunity zone investment, but the 90% of my assets under in my investments must be qualified over 70, and they must be in that zone for the 10-year period. So visually, just trying to make sense of the IRS's language for you. And so we'll go back to the slide presentation now that you've seen enough of my face. All right. So that's what substantially all. Now, asset churn. Let's talk about asset churn. The genius part of these new regulations and these new guidelines was I think they really thought this through appropriately. My overall gist of this updated regulation is it's really good legislation. It really is heading in the right direction. They are stopping the abuse opportunities, I think, in advance. And yet at the same time, they're not over-regulating and they're keeping things pretty sensible and pretty interesting as it relates to how money and capital and economic development really needs to work. And so I'm impressed by the law personally. That's my gut level. And here's one of the reasons why. Asset churn. So in the original October 2018 guidance, there was a 90-day period where if you sold this investment, so remember, I got to leave 90% assets under management in my thing for 10 years, right? 90% asset test. Well, let's say this business, I bought into it and this property was worth X and now it's worth 3X and there's a buyer and I want to sell it. Well, there in the original language, it was 90 days to redeploy that capital, reinvest that capital and not have a penalty or not have it disqualified. Now they're giving you 12 months. So when it comes to asset churn, this is going to allow fund managers specifically the ability to be patient, look at quality deal flow, run a strategy of both divestiture and everything else, while in the meantime, their LPs can just benefit from the IRR and the ongoing reporting and everything else. So that 12-month window is definitely healthy enough. It's not even 6 months. It's 12 full months before you would possibly fall out of that 90% asset test ratio. So I mean, I don't think it gets any better than that personally, just my opinion. All right, original use. Lots of questions about this. And one of the biggest things I think that this guidance provided is related to leasing, but we'll get about that in a second. So original use means they've now said that a tangible property that will qualify must be inside of an opportunity zone, but it has not yet been depreciated by any taxpayer. So not even just you, can't be depreciated by any taxpayer. Vacant property. The property, if it's vacant, has to have been vacant for 5 years. They did this primarily so that when the law first passed 18 months ago or whenever it was, that people couldn't just permanently vacate a building that was in a zone that they already had so that they could get it triggered inside of it as a new thing. So the original use is 5 years vacancy, not yet depreciated. And the new language that's great is that any improvements, so tenant improvements, build out, any improvements that are made on a leased property actually now qualify as original use, which is really good. And the original use requirement does not apply